what I'll be talking about is implementation toolkits. This is something we've been mentioning since Monday repeatedly, how we have toolkits for different use cases, different health areas that we worked on together with WHO, UNICEF, other partners. But we haven't really had a proper introduction to exactly what we mean when we talk about the implementation toolkits. So just sort of to clarify any misunderstandings about what these toolkits are and how they can be used in DHIS2 implementations, I'll do a brief session on this now. So the purpose is to understand what these are, how they can help you when setting up DHIS2. So my colleagues have been making fun of me for being too serious when I've been presenting stuff. So now I'll have some photos of Lego bricks and we'll all have fun. So this is DHIS2. It's an empty box that you can use to build whatever you want, like with the Lego. So when you start up with DHIS2, you don't really have anything. You have a software that can do lots of things, but it doesn't give you anything to start with. So what I wanted to do now, since there are some of you who have sort of very new to DHIS2 in general, I will actually make a new DHIS2 and I will add some stuff to it just to show you the sort of this building process. So I will make a new DHIS2. This is, of course, always a bit risky to do this live. Let's see if it's starting. Oh, sorry. So I need to use, I'm using now the latest version of DHIS2, starting up a new instance. So what I'll do now is to show an example of how you use this empty box, build something from scratch. So I'll pretend we're setting up a routine immunization program. So let's say we're making a monthly report from health facilities on how many children are given BCG doses, for example. Let's see if it's starting. Okay, so we now have a completely empty box, DHIS2. There is nothing here, no dashboards. I have no data sets. I have no indicators. I have no organization units. So the first thing I'll do is just to make a little org unit hierarchy here. So we have Norway. I'll add Oslo. And I'll make sure my user is assigned to the Norway org unit. Okay, so then I think I'm ready to make my data set. So I know for immunization, I want to have my data disaggregated under one, above one years. So the first thing I'll do is to make a disaggregation, which we call a categories in DHIS2. So this one will be 0 to 11 months. And I need also to have one for 12 plus months. This I will combine in age group for immunization. This is a disaggregation. It's a data dimension. I want to use this in my analysis. So I'm picking these two for my category for immunization age. I know this is going very fast. I'll get to the point eventually of doing this versus using the toolkits. So I have my disaggregation under 1, above 1 years. Now I need to have my data elements, my BCG doses. So I'm making a data element. BCG doses given. This should be aggregate. I'm making a monthly form. I'm not making something for the case-based. It should be a positive or zero integer. I don't want to have decimals in my count of children. I want it to be added up over time. Okay, what I need now is my reporting form, my data set. So this is my EPI monthly report. It's monthly, and I select BCG doses given. I want this to be reported at the facility level. So in this case, my only facility, I haven't really added any, but I'll, let's say Oslo is a facility. So I say this reporting form, which has one data element, should be reported from Oslo. Let's see if we have anything here. No, but it's public. No, but this is the... Okay, so... I need to specify here that the user can actually capture this data. So of course you would typically do this with a group of users, not with individual users, but just to make it quick, I'm doing it now directly with my account. Yeah, so sure, Ajit is now mentioning all the things I forgot. More tips, Rajit? What did I forget? I think this... Okay, so I'll try one last thing. If it doesn't work, then I think... Okay, so let's see if we can use the, we're working on the new, Okay. So let's give up the attempt to actually open the data entry on this one. The point being,
Hi, Olaf. My colleague here, she's asking. Sorry, my colleague here, she was asking because we saw that you spin DHS instance very quickly. So we are wondering like how much workload does it take if we really implement it in a country level? It's a silly question, but because you spend it very quickly. So I think you are using like a small database. Does this type of database accept many concurrent connections if we use it in a country level? This part one, part B, she's asking also, can we decide another type of database because for some reason, if we need to use our own, a SQL database, for example?
No, so that used to be the case before that you could choose between MySQL, Postgres, etc. But now we're standardizing around Postgres because it has GIS features, etc. that is used. I think, so now I'm just running it on this. I would actually think for aggregate, purely aggregate reporting, you could probably run a national system on a laptop. So it's only when you start with the case-based that you need to really scale up in terms of the hardware. Okay, so my point was to show sort of this process. Starting from scratch, you define your data elements, you define your data set, you define your org units. But of course, quite often, what you're doing is something that others are also doing. If you're doing immunization registry, it's the same immunizations you're giving more or less in all countries. If you're doing TB surveillance, it's more or less the same thing. So that's sort of the idea with this implementation toolkits, that there are so many things we see that everyone is doing more or less the same way. So we can provide some tools to make it easier to do those standard things. So my initial attempt to make a simple immunization registry example wasn't so successful. Let's try instead to make a tuberculosis case-based system. But rather than starting from scratch with my Lego bricks, I'll go and download the toolkit for TB. So this is now a predefined configuration. That I have here. This is the DHIS2 part of the toolkit. It's a JSON file. It basically looks like this. So it includes some of the things I was doing now with making category option for disaggregations, making data elements. It includes dashboards, it includes maps, all of these pre-configured things comes as part of this toolkit. So if I now go back to my DHIS2 and import this, okay, so we see it's creating lots of stuff here. That was just a test import. I'll do the real import and we'll see what happens. Okay, looks like it finished. See if I remember all the things I need to do now. I need to, first of all, make sure that I have access to this program, which is done through the user groups. So in this case, I should be an administrator who can change the program. I also want to show the data capture. I need to specify that we're collecting this tuberculosis data from my Oslo org unit. Let's see if I forgot something. No, here we have the TBK surveillance. I can start registering cases. Here, diagnosis. I can start collecting information. So that's sort of the idea with the toolkits. I have my DHIS, I can make my own stuff. But if I'm doing something that others have done and that people have worked on with WHO or with UNICEF on what are the standards, and we worked with the DHIS2 teams looking at what has been done in different countries, coming up with a good design, we can share them through these implementation toolkits and make it possible for others to use them by importing into DHIS2. So continuing with my Lego metaphor, the idea here is if I know I want to build this penguin or bird, I don't know what it is. If I know what I'm building, we can provide through these toolkits some instructions on how best to do that in DHIS2. So working with WHO and UNICEF, others, to see what are the things that should be included, what are the key indicators, etc. And working with the DHIS2 experts, what is the best way to model this in DHIS2? We can put together a toolkit that has some guidance on how to do this. We can make a DHIS2 instance available where people can look at the demo to see how it works. We can include these JSON files, what we call the metadata packages, for people to use in their own DHIS2. We can make training material that can be used along with this toolkit, etc. So what we say as a minimum for these toolkits is that we at least have some guidance describing how you address the use case in DHIS2, and ideally also a demo. The metadata packages is what we refer to with this JSON file that I was just showing, the actual configuration of DHIS2. So that's one component of the toolkit, is the part that you install in DHIS2. So that could be what we call a common metadata library, which has like some basic attributes like date of birth, names that can be reused. It can be just analytics, dashboards, indicators that you can link to your own data collection tools, or it can be the full data sets or programs with all the data collection. So the idea is, yes, you have DHIS2, you can build whatever you want. It's an empty box. But then we also provide these toolkits, which has sort of a use case, something you want to build. It includes instructions. It includes all the metadata, the parts you need. And then we have the demo, which is showing you how this works in the real life, in the daily use. So that's the toolkits. And then, like I said, it's something we're collaborating with WHO, UNICEF, others to develop. So we have, this is just an example of the areas where we have toolkits: HIV, malaria, TB, community health, EPI, CRVS, we've talked about, nutrition, etc. So with this, we take the guidance that exists around the health areas, turn them into a toolkit that can be used in the national DHIS2 implementations. So seeing that we're running out of time, I think I've covered most of this. So it includes the key content in a modular way, so you can sort of pick and choose. If we take the immunization toolkit as an example, it includes the immunization registry for doing case-based follow-up of children. It also includes the monthly reporting forms. Includes the stock component, for example, for doing the facility level logistics, and then countries can pick and choose what is relevant for them. So just a few examples, malaria toolkit. We have two modules depending on the situation in the country. Some countries are in what they call burden reduction, so they have a very high malaria burden. the focus is on reducing the cases. Other countries are in the elimination phase. They're trying to completely get rid of malaria. So there are different modules depending on the situation in the country. And in addition, we have the case-based modules for malaria elimination. Then we have the configuration in DHIS2 and the training material. Yeah, I think we mentioned many of these, especially on Monday, Tuesday. We talked about the different health areas. So we have the same for tuberculosis. For data quality, we had a session. We have toolkits for data quality with the standard metrics, dashboards, etc. So that's something you find on the DHIS2 webpage. You can have a look at what is available and how they can be used. So the last thing I wanted to say is sort of just a sort of a clarification. Because I think it's very easy to get sort of, yes, this toolkit's very useful. I don't have to do all the configuration. But that's not, you shouldn't just assume that because you're using DHIS2 for a health area where there is a toolkit, that you should use the metadata that comes in the package. You can also build very nice things, even though they sometimes look a bit funny, like this panda beer here. You can build things from scratch for the same sort of use cases that we have in the toolkits, and it might be a better solution for you. So you really need to consider, is it actually useful for me to take the JSON file with everything pre-configured compared to just using the guidance and looking at sort of the design advice that is in that and rather building from scratch yourself. So, summarize, these toolkits meant to help countries improve data quality analysis use, developed together with some of the global partners, WHO, UNICEF, available for a lot of programs, and meant to be used together in an integrated way. But you really need to think of, for each implementation, what is the best way to use this? Is it just to look at the guidance, the examples, or is it to actually use the content that comes with the toolkits?